Speaking of draft, it has begun already. Bans are on the board. Is that what I believe it is on the ban for NP? Is that a Wisp?
Yeah, it's a Wisp ban, yeah.
Careful, it's Io. Don't want to get serious here.
Oh, God. Okay, I'm just trying to use the fancy slang.
But he was called Wisp, and then they had to change his name.
I mean, that's rather strange, their first ban Sanking. MVP first ban Sanking. That's a Sanking first ban. That's very strange from MVP.
What did they ban last time with Naga? Was it Sanking also?
Trying to think.
So I feel like it was...
Was it the same ban?
NP banning differently. They went for Bounty Hunter Isle last game.
Oh, okay.
So, slightly different. 10 seconds remaining.
So what's open right now? The Warlock's still open again. Like, both teams have chose not to ban it. NP don't mind playing against the Warlock. Like I said, again, MVP is not a team that likes to play around cooldown spells. So they might be banking on MVP not picking the hero.
No Magi this time.
Yeah. No Magi.
It was so effective last game, honestly. Like, he had
it's a very good hero. Like, he just does so much, and especially with a Drow Shred, where you just want to push and use your rock as much as you can. It's really, really good together. The laning phase as well, like you said, it's very good.
What is the thought process behind the Naga Siren ban?
It's just Aoi's hero.
It's just taken away from
Aoi. Wait till you watch a game of Naga, read it out, 60 minutes, and there's not... you can't end the game now, but there's no way you win the game. Like, the game doesn't end at like 40, maybe like past like 30 minutes, you know it's going to be a difficult game. And the game doesn't end early, but you know you can't win.
You know it's coming.
Yeah, but she just sets illusions down the lane.
You can't win the game when it goes late against a Naga. And, and you know how disgusting it is. You have to sit in a game and you don't want to give up and you have to try, but you know your fate is certain.
I'm seeing smiles, Purge.
It's not just about the Naga. It's a respect ban. It's that Naga can be annoying and AUI is so disgustingly good at it. And maybe the thought is that it's the easiest hero to ban out that it's a different play style. It's hard to react to. There's so many layers of it, and
also
MP does it the best.
Don't you think it's partly like if you let in someone's favorite hero, and they pick it, you're like, why didn't we ban?
No,
you immediately think,
what? MVP plays the hero. MVP actually plays the hero.
Huh.
Oh, QO plays another. So
yeah.
But that's when you really hit, like, that's when you really make a statement.
They could pick it then, yeah.
They could have picked it.
Oh, well. Well, they've gone with Warlock instead. They saw how good it was.
They took a long time, though. They were, like, thinking about maybe letting it through, and probably there's a discussion where we don't want to play against that hero again.
They genuinely lost that game because of Fatal Bonds. Yeah. They lost multiple teamfights because of Fatal Bonds. Venno gave them a great advantage, but Fatal Bonds guaranteed that they lost every teamfight.
Yeah. Speak of the devil, he's back. And as is Drow Ranger, NP just going straight back to what they know.
Let's see if it works, actually. Kev was saying Fatal Bonds was a huge part of it, so we get to see now.
Okay.
Was it purely the Fatal Bonds? Was it just the Fatal Bonds that won the fight? Or can they win
it
even without?
It pushed you over from... it's one skill, right? You got 4 skill points into that, you throw double Star Storm and Venom Ulti on top of that, and it makes all those skills better by like 50%. That's a massive damage.
For
all heroes.
I agree. It's huge. But we can also see if they can do it without the Warlock,
so
what they do in its place.
Yeah, it makes sense. You're basically saying we can now see what Venom does.
Yeah, if you take the Warlock out, what effect does it have?
They do the same opening as MP. Warlock.
Okay.
Yeah, they just basically did the same opening as what MP did in the first game. They picked the Warlock and the Omni.
So it's just a mirror.
Like, yeah, it's a mirror.
If one other team does the strat all the time, and I would say NP definitely does it more than other teams, then they surely know the counter, right?
You'd hope so.
Justified.
I wouldn't say Venno beats Omni in a 1v1, really, because Repel, I mean, it's much lower duration than it used to be.
But you still struggle, like, any melee hero, I
guess you would.
Is going to struggle against Venno.
You'd probably just max Poison Sting over Gale, I would say, or maybe go like 2-3. Maybe.
Maybe you can. I think you can go for the wards against Omni and just push the lane and just get the tower early. Possible for him to do that. And they ban out the Rubick. A good hero, like I mentioned, against Warlock. Easy to steal his spells, very, very useful, just in general.
Yeah.
And the Darkseer ban as well?
Very common Phoenix offlane hero.
Right. Darkseer is very good with Warlock for two reasons. Number one, you have the vacuum into the rock combo plus the Fatal Bonds. And number two, it's because he's like a hero that keeps the lane pushed out. I mentioned before, like Warlock, when you draft Warlock, you need heroes that push the lane so that you can actually go to the tower and fight and use your rock to take an objective. So Darkseer allows your team to do that, apart from the vacuum combo.
Plus, it's very early game fighting, which fits perfectly into what MVP does. They'll grab like a melee core, throw an Iron Shell on him so he does way more damage than normal, and Surge as well, so you can actually kite, get out of fights, re-engage.
Surge against Venno. Seems good.
Yeah, maybe not in that case, but...
I like your giggle. I could just listen to it on loop at this point in time. But I'm waiting for waiting to see where this one goes next, considering it is MVP. Not running necessarily running out of time, but what would you think their thought process is now? You've got Warlock and Omni. You've been very, very kind of boring at this point in time. In fact, excuse me, we are waiting for MP second.
They banned Alchemist. They've banned Mirana in exchange.
I think they had to ban... that. Right now, MP has pretty good damage early mid, but it's more AoE teamfight stuff. They don't have super good single target. So they grab something tanky with Omni and Warlock, and that hero can do a lot of damage and stay alive. It could be really dangerous for MP.
They need some like disable for the draw. You know if MP actually runs the Venno on all positions like EG? Do they like jungle the Venno?
I'm pretty sure they could easily.
Exclusively MSS hero?
I feel like those two supports, SVG and Rose, I feel like they do alter a lot of things like that. Like they can definitely change
it up. I've not seen them like play really greedy, like have like someone jungle early. Like just like play really greedy and have like a dedicated jungler to get levels. Like Venno jungle is like super good.
Mm-hmm. Do you think it's worth pushing someone into the jungle and making your lanes weaker? Or would you rather have we want to win the lane super
hard. The thing
hard.
With Venno is like you jungle, you get level 4. I think 2.5 minutes you get level 4. And then the way they do it is like they get level 4 and they go to the safe lane, the enemy safe lane, and you just pressure, like you go and you annoy him.
Mm-hmm. So you have to bide your time for like 4 minutes and then you go and ruin their safe lane.
I'll say you reach the lane around, minute 3 minutes and a half, you'll be on the off lane pressuring. I don't think you should like 24/7 jungle.
Right. Yeah.
Just get lost in there. Witch Doctor, we were singing the praises of Witch Doctor earlier on, Kevin. We were saying, was it your words suggesting he was one of the best in the support role?
In tri-lane situations, yes. Just because Cass can bounce between hero to hero to hero to hero. He gives some heal as well, which can be nice for trying to play out against your opponent's heals as well. Maledict, not too bad.
Yeah, it's okay. It's good.
It's like a very flexible support because when you're under pressure, you like if your lane's getting pressured, you can choose to go for the Voodoo Restoration. But if you want to pressure like the off lane, you want to get kills, like if it's a lone hero, you always have the option to go for the Melody.
Yeah, he's good. He's one of my favorite heroes, and I mean his ult can be quite winning because you could just sort of plant your ult down, and you can if they're pushing up into you. Let's say you're at the top. Slot, jeez.
And Undying. Like MP is very very obvious about their intentions. They have like a core Venno or core Undying, probably a core Venno. Venno Undying Dole in, Witch Doctor Drow. They're just gonna have a lot of sustain to push. And for MVP, they're gonna need. They already have a lot of team fight with Warlock plus Omni Knight. So they're gonna have to defend their towers this game a lot. Like Slug is still pretty good against all their heroes. MP's heroes are not very good at catching Slug.
But I feel like they're good at overpowering huge gold advantage, and when they're 5-maning, they're going to be defensive enough against
Slug. Yeah, needs a lot of items against his lineup. He's going to need a long time to farm before he's able to join the fights. He's going to need his team, the War, Omni, and whoever they're going to pick after to handle the early
to late game.
Yeah, to drag the game. Well, he doesn't need to get to late game, but mid game.
Okay.
Shadow Blade plus one item.
And then Slark's online.
Yeah.
Usually Shadow Blade, Echo Saber. This game he might need more than that because MP's like aggression will be really, really fast.
Is it too crazy to go Blink Dagger this game on Slark and do like Blink Pounce
with
Purify?
I always like Blink Dagger on Slark against Drow especially, but very little players actually do that. Mostly just prefer Shadow Blade because it gives you much more kill potential with the attack speed.
Weaver.
Ooh, okay. So MP really lacking disables.
Yeah.
Weaver can time-lapse himself. It's not the best counter against Venno just because it's damage over time. You're not getting the brunt of it. You're just getting part of it.
Might be an like a off-lane Weaver with a support Omni, like dual-lane pressure. Not sure if they're going to do that. It's pretty good. Like you can see the change of direction between the first phase and the second phase where in the second phase, MVP chose to go for very flexible heroes, very mobile heroes, Slug and Weaver. When they see MP building a draft around heroes that are very strong in the lane, but they don't have very good lockdown, so they can't catch heroes that are very mobile.
Like the MP's chase potential and the catching people is minimal. Yeah,
it's
like,
very bad.
There's literally you'd have to be horribly out of position and get galed or some kind of downtown bongo to catch you.
I mean, if you're a Weaver, you get galed. You're still gonna get away.
Yeah, exactly.
Unless you get silenced by Jarl. So
yeah, they've got no catch. But so is their plan here is literally just to group up behind the tower, just push.
You'd
have to fight into us. That's it.
MVP is gonna have to rely on the big cooldowns to defend the towers. And meanwhile, when they don't have the big cooldowns, they have very good speed push Slug, and Weaver can push up the lanes really quick, like far, and MP can't really catch them with their current four heroes. They're gonna need maybe a last hero that can actually allow them to have some sort of catch.
Do you think Storm That's a pretty good ban from
Yeah,
from
Storm Phoenix. Storm is pretty good against their heroes. Yeah. They can catch them. And if you look at MVP's own four heroes, they don't have very good lockdown.
Yeah,
for Storm.
They actually lack stuns as well.
So you've got, like, what, neither catching? Oh, is that a sniper?
Yes, it is.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's a lot of good solutions against Tombstone.
They
can basically put Weaver and Slark in the front. They can be saved by Omni and Warlock, and then Sniper sits back and just pings away.
Yeah, but it's very greedy, though. Yeah, early game might be I'm not sure how the early game will go. It might be very difficult for them. Mm. All their three cores require a huge amount of farm, like a lot of farm, all three of them. Remaining. They're going to take up a lot of space. So the supports are not going to get anything, and they're going to have to make sure that they don't lose the lane. Because with this three cores, if you lose your lanes, it's going to be very difficult to come back.
And right. The supports can't even like gank rotate either, because they don't have good gank skills.
They're really. Basically there to make sure they don't die in the lanes.
Yeah.
Well, yes, so what? Taking what you've told me already, Winter and Co. Oh, he's putting a funny face. Quap.
You don't trust the Envy Quap?
I just don't like Quap in general.
Okay, you've said this twice now. We are going to quickly shed light on this. It's going to have to be very brief. Can you tell me why Quap sucks in 5 words?
She is a bad hero. She is a bad hero. Yeah.
Well, that's so helpful. So much light shed upon this beautiful desk. So are we going to see a third map? I just want like a couple of nods and shakes.
I think Phoenix have a good chance if they can do okay in the early game. Okay. Yeah.
So they're going to have to survive and weather the storm of the early game. But our desk does think we could very well see a third. Winter places faith in MVP. We'll see if it was misplaced as we do head over to our casters and jump into our second game of this lower bracket game. Not lower bracket. Losers game.
Well done.
It's a loser's game, but everyone's obviously a winner at heart. She is a bad hero, fogged. I'm dazzled by both the lights in front of my eyes as well as Winter's intellect.
What?
Your thoughts on the Queen of Pain? It didn't work too well for Envy last time he did it.
I think, ideally, they don't want this game to go super late. Like Winter said, all three cores on the side of MVP, these guys need items. They need to delay the game as much as possible. So, like, Ted and Winter kind of hit it on the point, too, like, especially with their last couple points. MVP needs to come out very well in this laning phase, take the game to the later stages. NP doesn't want this to happen. They want to be able to crush the lanes, fight as much as possible early, take towers. And I think the Queen of Pain kind of works for that. And it's like, it's a hero that they just felt like there's no real lockdown at all on the side of MVP. So he can maybe just snowball in that factor.
But that's from both sides. And my concern is for the Queen of Pain is you don't get an early enough Orchid on him that the Lincolns is over on the Weaver. And then there's just no answer. Or you already have the Repel up from the Omni Knight. There's so many ways that things can go horribly wrong. This is a way that things go horribly right, where Febby gets caught out. They have no more stuns. And AUI is not in range. He's not going to level up for us. Arrows at level 1. So they can't even reach him. And this is just going to be one of those games, right, where everyone walks away from each other and they just play a game of chase.
I think we're going to see the same thing from last time from NP. They're going to do a aggro tri-lane with a Venomancer short lane. They even already started like running down at the bottom lane. They de-warded instantly. They took out the Obs ward that was blocking out the hard camp from them, and they even put a ward down to block the pull camp. So I think we're probably going to see, well, not 100%, but we'll probably see that type of same thing as the last one.
But MVP also have that kind of like dynamic lane option too. Like they can just leave the Weaver on the bottom lane, put in with Febby to start with. Like we were talking about it during the drafting phase. Like MVP's not limited to anything. Even the sniper doesn't need to go mid. We were actually originally talking like what happens if you run that Slark into the mid lane instead. Like go back to the old classic MVP mid melees. But the matchup of sniper versus Queen of Pain is just a little bit too hard to resist.
Yeah, I still think though, like MVP, I think they're gonna struggle really hard in this laning phase. They need this to go well for them, but I think it's super hard. Like they don't really have a frontliner for the sniper, for the Slark, even for the Weaver. Obviously the repel and everything makes it a bit easier with your Warlock in the back lines, but still, like these heroes, I'll keep saying it too, these guys need so much farm on those three cores.
Yeah. So it's up to MP to try and shut them down. Look at AUI, he actually went for the first put up in Cold Arrows. Yeah. He's trying to be the harassment against the Weaver, force out Shikuchi, because when that Shikuchi's down for Rev, you actually have kill potential in the lane. But Febby's right behind him, top lane, Velo. This is a good lane for him. In fact, this is actually a fantastic lane for MVP. It's the aggressiveness that comes from the Slark, but it's the early damage that also comes from a Warlock, which Venomancer cannot contest.
Yeah, definitely a very smart lane setup doing the dual lanes for MVP. They even they did find that ward that was blocking their pull by putting two sentries down, but SVG very smart, just constantly walking over and body blocking it. So that's something they have to make sure to keep doing so that they can keep the lane equilibrium going their way and also be sure to be able to pull the side and get as much XP. Should be fun, right?
He doesn't have Blink Dagger, and that's the only reason why, like, if you had a point up and take aim, QO would have a better chance of that. But he went headshot as well as Shrapnel, obviously, for the first points in the Sniper.
Yep.
But he stood his ground. He most definitely stood his ground up against QR. But he's now burned all his consumables, and apart from one shared tango, and QR is in a very similar position. And they're both very far off having, but in fact, they're almost exactly the same money on the way to bottles.
Yep, just it should be a pretty trade-off lane here. I think QO should probably come out a bit ahead in it. But there is the Drow Aura for Envy, but it's all about the lane positioning here. And we'll see if they do actually decide to do like slight rotations. Maybe the Warlock just comes over and bullies Envy just for a moment. But I think he should probably just stay more so in the top lane until Slark gets some more levels. But as I say that, he does walk toward mid.
Yeah, he also needs to make sure Slark can get those levels.
A dying Haste Rune. He's only level 1.
And if he runs towards the mid, the Warlock is sitting behind. Dubu is level 2, so he's got both Fatal Bonds as well as Shadow Word. So he actually links Envy up with the Creep Wave.
Lots of pressure.
And that's enough. But Undying's now back onto the bottom lane. But you can go on Ferev. Ferev knows the Sentry Ward is there because of the D Ward that happened previously. Shikuchi gives him enough distance. You don't have Decay off cooldown for Savage just yet. Ferev will have to use that salve of his.
They're accomplishing what they want in this aggro trillion, though. They're keeping the lane pulled back. Obviously, they're pulling the side to constantly be able to split the levels and keep the lane at a good spot so they can farm, and it doesn't let the Weaver farm. So the pressure is there from NP for sure.
Is the sacrifice worth it, though? Because now the Slark... Are you going to get early levels on the Slark to start with? But more importantly, he's getting the farm to get closer towards like early Shadowblade, and then it's very, very troublesome for all these heroes of NP.
Yeah, they're even making sure to farm the event awards too, because MSS, as soon as the Warlock left, he started putting some points in it to try to pressure the Slark a bit, but Warlock making the movement back up there right away.
But that's the upside of having Warlock, such high base damage, killing off those Plague Wards is not really that much of a problem for him as a support, which frees up the Slark to focus on farming or potentially killing.
Yeah, and it's great that he doesn't have to worry too much about getting like extra farm or extra regen or anything on the Slark in the early laning phase. He can just get Shadow Worded up after he burns through his tangos, which he did early on.
Oh, this bottom lane, it's...
really pressuring this Weaver. He has 5 CS.
Yeah, it's not a lot, but now at least he can farm underneath the tower. He's still got Febby behind him in case times get rough. And by finishing up the full magic wand, he got an answer to this decay spam that's coming from the Undying.
Yeah, but they're going to just... The thing is that they're being very smart. Like, in the situations they notice, they're like, okay, we're going to push it into their tower, and then we're going to pull the side and deny a full creep wave. Push it in, pull it back, constantly just rinse, repeat, make sure they spread experience as much as possible, and make sure the Weaver doesn't really get too much of anything. A couple CS into the tower, sure, but 6 CS, not where he wants to be, but the trade-off is that Slark has 30.
Yeah. He has 30. The Sniper is 7 ahead of the Queen of Pain. Of course, this is around the same time as we saw Eternal
Envy
rotate before as, he'll get the Gale on Dubu. So Dubu does the wise thing and just TP straight back out again. Velo's gonna cut his way to freedom. Now, I'm very concerned about, like, just Eternal Envy's timing. You look for the Queen of Pain first rotation. He did it too early with the Queen of Pain previously. This time around, he's a little bit behind QO. Like he's half a level, if not a full level, behind QO at the moment.
That one Fatal Bond rotation by the Warlock actually really pressured him super hard. Because he had to go back, he had to wait for his bottle, and then QO obviously getting the double Wraith Band, he's able actually to match up versus that Drow Ranger aura with the Queen of Pain. I think they're trying to make a play for top for Bello, but I don't think that this is going to work. Yeah, he's got Pounce, he's out.
And this is another reason why we're looking in Slark to be picked up in the mid part of the draft, is because there was, again, like, no real lockdown, and Slark just thrives in such a scenario.
Yeah, two lanes definitely going highly in favor of MVP right now, while obviously the Weaver is being sacked quite a bit, but, I mean, like, that's kind of okay, right? You do want your Slark to be free farming, you want your Sniper to be farming. Weaver can just catch up by like, the split.
You don't want AUI getting caught out like this. Purification on bottom lane, he starts his TP, so AUI will survive. Goes all the way back home.
I think this is like actually the best situation that could happen. Like your Weaver being pressured like this is fine because later on he can split push freely. There's actually like no way of them killing him in like the lanes when he's doing the split push.
And it's MP that has to rotate first, right? Because you got QO's about to attack into the mid tower. Zubu's not too far behind in level, so then you're also going to have that big ultimate. The panel was saying like maybe MP know the answer to dealing with a Warlock. At the same time, they also understand how much respect they have to give Warlock when he hits that level 6. Planned their entire game 1 win around that momentum shift, which comes with a Warlock rock.
Yeah, I mean, Dubu's finding his levels too. Like, even though he's kind of like walking around between the mid and top lane, he's already level 4, 6 minutes. It's pretty decent.
Rose was looking for the ward that Dubu put down.
juked him out walking up the hill there. And look at Dubu. Look at, he walks up and hit just Fatal Bond's Envy. Not feeling any pressure right now.
Oh, why would you? At the moment, like, your sniper is rotated with a double damage into the top lane, hoping that Savage just comes far enough out that he can be, like, ensnared up in the leash of Veiler.
He does kind of seem like he knows something's up. Like the Warlock taking the mid lane, that's kind of a telltale sign that there's a rotation happening.
It's either that or you think the sniper's just gone jungle. Like that's the other thing. Maybe he's pulling and farming. They don't have any vision deeper inside the MVP jungle.
They're mirroring each other's movements. Envy moves bottom, the sniper goes top, the two supports take mid.
This rotation timing though of Envy is really good, but that Gust from AUI, it really needed to connect.
QO's
now
down
the Gale over on Febby, but the Scarab Beetles, MSS losing armor quickly, the TP out, the Fatal Bonds connects them, MSS will drop, AUI being assassinated, he'll go down to the sniper. Eternal Envy will bail out, he didn't trigger a single ability in that gank, which was meant to be initiated by MP.
Well, what did we say that? What did we say that MVP needs in this game? They need a good laning start, and they're getting it right now. So this is looking a bit scary for NP. Obviously, it's very early on in; they can definitely recover from it. But this is the tool that MVP needed to make their draft work into the mid game, into the later stages.
What a fight for also Dubu to be involved in. Half a level away from his level 6. Mana is an issue for him at the moment, so they'll probably have to reset shortly after. But MP's got the push. There's tier 1 tower. I mean, MVP's got the push. MP's got no counter push to stop this. So the first tier 1 tower's gonna drop 8 minutes, and it's to the team that doesn't actually have the draw.
Yeah, there's no deep push, and then, like, once this, like, Repel gets a couple more levels, it's actually, like, almost impossible to kill the hero that's repelled up. They have, sure, the Queen of Pain has pure damage, like, there's physical damage coming up, and with the Venno on top too, but once Guardian Angel comes out, it counteracts even more, so...
It asks a question then, like, Eternal Envy, we saw him build the Orchid on his Queen of Pain earlier today. With all of the counters to the Orchid already naturally in the heroes of MVP, do you still build
pressured.
It? Yeah, Kuro's still got a couple of stick charges, however, so he's getting away from the Undying, and then Valo just nukes down the Undying on the backlines. Kuro's making it to the tree lines, the Shadow Strike is keeping him low. Now the blink forward, Envy a little bit too far away. The one attack will do the work. But Valo now also finds the Witch Doctor with the damage from the Dark Pack, 36, and now zero life on that Witch Doctor. So Envy gets one, but the Slark is getting momentum with two. Maybe the support's for a call there.
Definitely a bigger gain for... Actually, it's probably pretty even. That's why Sniper was worth quite a lot. But Velo getting that acceleration is definitely massive. Like, once he gets that Shadow Blade, these supports... Even the Venomancer is, like, pretty free food. I mean, Drow Ranger, too. They put him inside of, like, a... Obviously, like, that offlane, so he's not completely free farm. So he's even pretty susceptible to getting ganked up very easily by once that Shadow Blade comes out.
Gale's gonna miss there from MSS. Very difficult to keep control of a Weaver.
They're feeling a bit pressured, you know, they're like, okay, we gotta, like, do something, like, we're gonna move all the heroes to the safe lane.
It's already too late, though, like, you've just lost your tier 1 tower on top lane, NP.
Yeah, they gotta do something, you know, they're playing a Drow Ranger lineup, they've got level 6 on him now, too. This is the time for them to group up to pressure a tower, at least with 4 heroes, and let Envy do his own thing.
Yeah, they're losing out too hard, though. Fortify on the Dire Structures, the tier 1 tower is now 2 hits away for Valo on top. That one belongs to him.
Yeah, he's gonna have Shadow Blade by like the 12-minute mark, maybe even earlier than that.
The mid tower is also down to 460. That's what Envy is trying to stop, but
Dubu
right now
six.
He's just holding a D push. Now they look for the opening.
They may not have pressured this bottom tower soon enough. The rotation's coming in from MVP. They have a TP even on Velo too, so they're gonna get outnumbered. The scan comes out.
Oh, Envy! Envy's coming up. He's gonna haste her and he's gonna walk right in the middle of Q on Dubu. No, he runs over to the lane instead. They don't find him straight away. They're still under the cover of smoke, but Eternal Envy with the haste rune runs down. Sniper smoke will break, a quick scream. They throw down the Dire Observer ward as well, so a little bit of vision. The plague wards are in behind the tower. So MVP can't even hide down there, but they're not full. Like, there's not everybody here. The Slark is a TP scroll. He's almost finished up his Shadow Blade, but Envy jumps in, looks to actually go for the ult, even though the rock will fall! The Fatal Bonds connecting up two of them, Envy and Rose tied together, AUI can't do enough damage, so Weaver actually just takes it, shrugs it off by using that time-lapse. And MP are on the run, Shrapnel will make this difficult, the slow is there, Forever's on their tail, they've got the Golem coming forward, MSS, looks like he's a goner with a pounce forward, the Slark gets involved, no Shadow Blade, but it won't matter, Rose taking so much damage, Eternal Envy is still linked to him, now the assassination comes in, Rose should be dead from this, thankfully for Envy, no longer connected, Fatal Bonds wore off.
This is not looking good for NP. At all. Shadow Blade already is coming out now. He actually has a Shadow Blade on the Slark already. He's in the back lines. SVG gonna get jumped up. He's dead.
There's no escape. Leashed up And now, even with the rock up, they don't have the creep wave with them, however, so the tier 2 tower will take a little bit longer to kill.
And this was NP's time to, like, they wanted to be able to get that tower quicker, but MVP quick to move all their heroes. Even though the scan came out from Dire, they knew the rotation was coming from MVP, but they really wanted to get this tier 1. It's super important from the get-go, but MVP just bringing the numbers and having that teamfight advantage with the Warlock Golem, with the Fatal Bonds.
I'm wondering, too, like, if MP really want to have more vision, and we'll talk about that in a second, as Eternal Envy looking for a kill on Dubu. They don't have the damage. He actually had the Sonic Wave. Didn't want to let it rip, and that was that hesitation I kind of wanted to flag on the bottom lane. Envy jumps in, but without the vision on... Envy? Envy, if there's an extra headshot in that one, he's lost the vision up the hill. And top lane Velo's about to kill off AUI. AUI should notice this. He's lost his aura, and now the damage is enough. So a solo kill. But yeah, that Sonic Wave, you could see him stopping. He didn't have vision of the Omni Knight.
Yeah.
And then the purification happens, like, okay, well, my ulti's not going to be worth it anymore.
That's kind of the thing about when you, like, why Winter probably said, you know, Queen of Pain's a bad hero. It's a super ulti cooldown reliant hero. 135 second cooldown. Like, even down there, if he ults the Warlock, that's pretty much like MVP would be like, okay, cool, he ulted me, my ult is down, we're just going to go, we're going to push towers down as fast as possible. So that's pretty much, you know, that's a reason why Queen of Pain isn't favored so highly now.
We're wondering why they weren't actually looking into something more like the Invoker, which was like a more go-to hero for Envy. Like, when they go into the last phase, and for the bans, like, you're thinking OD and Invoker were high up in the list.
I think that's why, like you were saying, that's probably why, like, MVP picked the Sniper, to try to, like, deter them away from picking the OD, maybe, like, as well as the Invoker.
But you'd still be happy with the Invoker. Like, we're also saying, like, there's no heavy rotations to come from MVP that's really going to phase the Invoker. So it's just purely that one-on-one lane. In fact, it was MP who had the better rotations.
Yeah, just, I mean, very hard for them, though. Like, they're you can tell, like, they're feeling pressure. They're putting down very defensive wards. They had, of course, one aggressive ward, but they're not feeling good about this game at all. And I mean, I can't blame them. Like, they're playing versus their strategy from the last game, kind of in a manner, with the Omni Knight Warlock. It seemed like they had an idea of how to deal with it, but their lineup has no disable whatsoever, and MVP picked two cores which thrive versus that.
Man, we're just looking at Canopy on our screen for so long. I'm just thinking, like, MP's thing. Evolve to Metapod, harden. Just, like, survive MVP for the next little bit, and maybe you can get your critical items up. I still don't know exactly what the critical item is on the co-op. Because you can't go off
either.
Good. Like, Ags doesn't make that much sense either.
It makes it like we kind of said, that the with their draft that they ended up grabbing up with the Queen of Pain, with the Drow, with Undying, with Witch Doctor, even with Venno, like, all their heroes are kind of like these early lane dominators. And then obviously if you get a pretty decent advantage in the laning phase, you're extremely powerful going into the mid game. But if you lose all three of your lanes, well, two lanes. They won one lane. But yeah, it makes it super hard to be able to fight it. Like, with MVP's lineup too, like the Omni, the Warlock, these two are supports, but they are the big team fighters. They're supports with the huge team fight, which is super important. While on the side of NP, big team fighters are cores. It's a Venno, it's the Queen of Pain. And they're not able to even use their team fight abilities in comparison.
Kuro is going to bring out the Oro Club in for QO. We have the Tome of Knowledge coming out for Rose. That's going to be his level 6, so Death Ward's now on the field for MP in the next fight, too.
Might help a little bit, but they, like we said, very little lockdown to keep them in the Death Ward.
It's locked up in the time of his life. So again, MP, they're going to bring the numbers down to bottom lane, and they have to commit. Blink, forward, they don't have detection, they can't see the Weaver. The Sentry Ward's a little bit further up. Weaver's not running into it. In fact, it's going to be... It's all about MP going underneath the Tier 1 tower. Let the Death Ward go. Dubu tanks through so much of it, while Ferev, now he chases for revenge, looking for the kill over on Rose.
Oh,
the silence is out, and now this could be a big one with the Sonic Wave. They do find the kill.
Great gust there by UI, for sure. A lot of money going their way, too. They even claim the tower. Oh, some distorted sound, it seems.
MP having issues.
Mm-hmm.
But that's huge for them. Like, yes, it took a long time to kill off the Warlock. Yeah, he's really tanky. But the AUI timing of Gust, that's the Weaver. One charge just wasn't enough, even with the treads. For a team that doesn't have a lot of lockdown, that's an olive branch right there from MVP.
It's definitely a bit of a giveaway, but at the same time, they are getting something out of it. It's not like they're just like they committed too many heroes to the bottom lane and lost two, and then they were like, ah, crap, we just need to run away. They're pressuring the two other lanes at the same time. So it looks very, very good for MP, but at the same time, I'd say it's even maybe a little bit MVP favored in a kind of a way, just because if they do claim this tier 1 if they claim this tier 1 mid, then it's definitely MVP favored. Otherwise, I'd say it's very slight edge to NP with that rotation.
We're actually watching Eternal Envy's perspective, and you can see it, like, he lost sight of the Weaver, Dubu gets initiated on, and he understands, like, they're here for the Weaver, and they just have to wait for that perfect opportunity. And, like, Ferev kind of came to them. Perfect. There's that gust timing from AUI, and the rest, as they say, is,
yeah. It was history. Like 0.1 second, and he probably would have time-lapsed right away after that Shikuchi auto-attack onto Rose. But yeah, great gust by Aoi, and yeah, this is what they need to recover. Like, obviously, like, they are extremely behind in this laning phase already, like, almost 8,000 gold in the favor of MVP. They need to 5-man. I mean, it's a draw lineup. That's usually what you need to do, but it's also a way to kind of bring yourself back into a game when the big ulties aren't down, or when they're separated in that type of position.
So after they take this tower, like, they're taking the T1 tower, they get 2 kills for the price of 1. You're losing your tier 2 on the top, and you're losing your tier 1 in the mid. Is it worth going back to defend this one, or is MP almost backed into a corner where you need to have something like Roshan, for example, get the Aegis, the Immortal, and then just ball it down? But then you're still fighting into a Warlock, right? So maybe
it's too hard.
It doesn't do enough work.
I think it's too hard for them to really go for that Rosh. If they do try to go for that Rosh, especially in this situation right now, I think it's very obvious. Like, Velo's just constantly pressuring this top lane, the sniper's pressuring the mid lane. If they see this Venom move from bottom lane, they're like, okay, they're going Rosh 100%. So NP's next moves are just kind of like sticking together. They need to kind of just wait for this Queen of Pain ulti too. That's like all their damage in this.
MVP's moving over. They have a perfect Observer Ward. They can see AUI, and they probably watched the replay. They know that AUI did exactly this maneuver in the first series of the day.
MV mid.
Or they could just catch out Eternal Envy. That's another option. Assassination, that's not enough damage. It's only a level 1 assassinate right now for the sniper. So AUI does the farm. The Observer Ward scouts it out. The D Ward from Rose is too far off position. Now it's going to be the tier 2 tower in the mid lane just slowly chipped away.
Yeah, this is smart. You know, they don't really have any obviously they don't have like something like a Beastmaster or something to like enable them to push much harder. They have a sniper just peeping at the tower. They have a Weaver and a Slark.
Oh, Weaver. He's running into the Sentry Ward. Paralyzing Cast. There goes your Gust. And do they have enough damage before the silence wears off? For Rev!
Just enough.
That's still only a level 1 Gust, but it did the work, so...
That was a bit...
For Rev will drop.
That was a bit... cocky by him, I feel. You know, they had the ward on the high ground there. They did see at least the Drow Ranger there. So he knows he can get the potential of gusted up. And he also has his team already hitting the mid tower. I guess he was trying to go for a wraparound play to try to go for, pincer them in kind of a way. But definitely a little bit of a risky move from him there. And he pays with his life.
MVP still kind of get what they want, or do they? Now they're losing the sniper, but the rock drops. The Fatal Bond, it doesn't connect them all, however. Eternal Envy not locked into all of this, but it's Velo taking a heavy amount of damage. And Envy wants to chase, misses his Blink Scream. They trigger the Guardian Angel and now look to turn this fight around as the Warlock, he is going to go down. Witch Doctor actually denied the tower in the midst of the craziness of this fight. Undying cannot TP out in time. MVP, just at the end of the day, way
MSS
too strong.
Getting
and
chased down by Ferev, the last auto attack.
Yep.
Ferev shows up and he's like, oh, a kill. Thank you. But yeah, nice little deny there by Rose for sure on the Witch Doctor, but definitely a big game there from MVP. Obviously,
they
have the big cooldown reliant team, and they used everything there. They used Guardian Angel, they used Rock, they used everything they possibly could. NP had a pretty good potential there going in, though. They didn't have the Sonic Wave, which was definitely like that little bit of burst that maybe would have brought Velo down. But yeah, just MVP leading the way here for sure. And it does seem like Envy feels like he's kind of forced to maybe go for like a BKB. He's picking up the Ogre Club first, so not like a point booster if he wants an Aghanim. More than likely that BKB. Even though they don't have any lockdown, it's just he feels like
they're coming in to contest Roshan. They need vision inside the pit. Eternal Envy, Roshan's really low. Envy just walks in, the sentry wards are down, and now it's actually AUI. Velo already walked out to initiate, and they're all getting hit with Fatal Bonds and the Dark Pack. The damage builds out so heavily. The Undying is dying to an Urn Charge, so he'll fall down too. And it's only MSS, the last sole survivor of MP, coming to contest Roshan. So two catastrophes of team fights in a row for MP in the space of 2 minutes.
I honestly think that they lost their window in this game. I think it's extremely difficult for them to come back. I think it's probably like 80% or something, maybe even higher for MVP to win this game right now. Like, their ulties are going to be coming back up, and NP can't even fight into it when they don't have their ults. So they picked a lineup that definitely needs to win in the laning phase. They won one lane, but they got, you know, they got pressured way too hard in the other two. And just look at, like, MVP's got incredible warding right now down in this game. They've got, like, 5 wards on the map in aggressive positions just to kind of more so lock NP into their base, just suffocate them even more.
Yeah, nowhere for MP to come out and farm, so no items really going to arrive. Like, the Drow Ranger's going to get enough money to finish up a Shadowblade. We'll watch that attempt again, but the movement from Velo was just too good.
Yeah, gets right on top of AOI, gets grabbed up. purification onto three fatal bonded heroes, and that's just like, they're all just straight up dead there. MSS trying to struggle to run away, but everybody else is already dead. The damage is done.
Courier's making the trek out. It's actually coming in with the Shadow Blade in the mid lane. Instantly gets sniped out. And now Velo, he jumps in. He wants to kill. Rose goes for the Death Ward, but the purification again doesn't work. Combining it with the Dark Pack, it's just so much AoE damage. And the Rock is still up, plus the GA. MP, they just can't fight. There's no damage to inflict because they've got nothing to penetrate MVP. This feels like game.
I think it is. I think they're probably feeling it as well. It's, you know, they, like we all said it too on the panel, like this MVP draft is very good going into the mid and later game, especially if they, I mean, if they come out good in the laning phase, it's extremely hard for MP to do anything.
I think MP have bets down in their predictions. They need to have the plus 20 minute game in order to keep their hopes alive for compending and predictions.
One last fight. That's kind of what it comes down to here. They've got Envy position in the back line with the Haste Rune. He's got Sonic Wave. He's only level 10, so it's not a level 2 Sonic Wave, but they're going to try to go for something.
Oh, there's your nice Sonic Wave. It's going to hit for Velo. He's away. The regeneration was enough, and then three hero final bond off. They have to get rid of the Scarabeetles. Blink away will actually save Eternal Envy, dodging the assassination. So the mid racks, the melee is down. They cannot go for more MVP unless they want to go for tier 4 towers. And that's still pretty confident, even with the lack of Sonic Wave. Savage is still hitting a couple of dual decays, so MVP will not take the risk and they will back out.
Everybody's just like full HP again on the side of MVP. Like this Omni Knight is actually putting in so much work. Now he's got a mech finished up too, guarding Greaves at base once it ever comes back. And they're just going to keep going. There's no point in them backing out by any means. They're just going to keep the pressure on. They don't really need to even worry about pushing lanes up.
And there's that mid matchup, QO versus Eternal Envy. You can be involved in the same, but the hero damage is just light years apart. And like, QO has done almost double the amount of damage in team fights that Eternal Envy has managed to achieve.
Yeah, I mean, this Slark is massive. Like, it's only 19 minutes, and he's got Shadow Blade, Echo Saber, and the Bastards coming out already. So he's way ahead of his timing that you want to be as a Slark.
Well, here they come. Observer and Sentries are down, so there's no easy way for Slark just to Shadow Blade in, but Philly doesn't care. He just walks up to the high ground anyway. He's like, oh, if you want to fight me, then fight me. Sonic Wave still on cooldown for 62 seconds. That's 62 seconds, way too long. So all they can do is paralyzing cast, decay spam, wait out the timing and make sure they don't get screwed over by MVP. And MVP don't want to force the issue either.
They're 30, waiting for
33
ults.
Until Rock's up.
Waiting for both ultis to come up. They've got the defusal now as well on the Weaver. But yeah, I mean, even if the Sonic Wave lands on a lot of targets, they have the mech already on, or the Guardian Greaves on Febby, so he's able to just completely counteract all that damage. He even went for max degen aura. I didn't even notice that on the Omni. He didn't even max repel.
Well, why? Didn't repel get massively nerfed? Degen now the new thing?
I guess so, right?
Kuro's gonna love this. He knows he wants to end too. Like he gets like an S and Y after his Dragon Lance. No Hurricane Pike, no need to work into something like a Manta.
Early stats, for sure.
Yep.
Rose peeks his head a bit too far. He peeped a little bit, but he's okay.
Really, Kuro just wants to make sure he can get vision on the tower. Velo will tank the damage, because he knows he can just back out. He'll have purification if someone initiates on him. He's still got the Greaves, he's still got the Shadow Word regeneration too.
Yeah, he's just giving high ground vision. He actually just walks up as Febby.
Yep, so Kuro can do the work. And that tier 3 tower is dropping down low. Okay, Ferev! Oh, Ferev! Just slipped in through the rear. Envy wants something, but now he's actually gonna die! The assassination's coming in! Eternal Envy's down! There's a double kill for Ferev, and MP scattered to the winds, and then rocked up! MP will lose game 2. MVP triumphing with a wonderful combo, a beautiful lane setup. Dual lanes worked, the rotations were nice, and they always seemed to have a really good answer. Like NP, that multiple times they attacked the bottom lane, they were there, they were enforced, they're in good position, and they just got the better trade.
Yep, you took the words out of my mouth, honestly. That lane set up by them was perfect, honestly. Putting the Warlock top gets the Slark pretty much free full arm. Thought we might see a rotation from NP, maybe moving somebody toward the top lane, but they looked like they just wanted to kind of just like keep their like aggro tri lane. It worked, you know, the aggro tri lane. Yep.